So there's been this strain of thinking on the real left, that Sanders is just basically stamping out any kind of real, political movement in favor of the bourgeoisie. The whole thing, right? To be honest with you, I think that the argument is basically correct on some level. This is a counterpunch, which is a kind of a it's a kind of a libertarian source, but it's kind of like it kind of swings back and forth. They publish articles by right libertarians and left libertarians. So it's just kind of like a broad libertarian source. Again, I'm not a Democrat. I'm not a progressive. I'm an anarchist, an anarcho-communist, a left libertarian socialist. So I'm not in your tent, but I kind of might want to pull you out of the tent, kind of thing. And I do think that this article is actually describing the situation properly. It's just that it's overestimating where America stands in its social advancement. If America were Europe or Canada, this argument would be reasonable, but the levels of inequality in America, along with its culture of glorified militarism, and its, in truth, widespread working class support for the most brutal types of social Darwinism imaginable, make it more comparable to Dickensian Britain. And the necessary tactics more aligned to those used there or elsewhere when the social advancement was so low. American leftists need to stop thinking of America as an advanced country and reject the kind of tactics we have been using in the modern world in favor of the kind of tactics that the modern world utilized a century prior, when it was at the level of social development that America is at today. So America cannot be talking about moving from advanced capitalism to communism or socialism, right? It can't be talking about making that transition. You can talk about making that transition elsewhere in the world that didn't deindustrialize. But America has pulled the entire rug out from underneath itself and has put itself back into Gilded Age conditions. And so leftists have to adjust to that and mentally move themselves back to where they were. It's a shitty deal, but maybe we shouldn't have let that happen. Canada's moved backwards, but not nearly as far, right? You need to think of America the same way you think of Mexico, because that's about where it is, right? The social revolution has to come first, but in America, they need a social awakening before they can have a social revolution. The struggle in America should consequently be focused on winning the kinds of basic reforms that have been won elsewhere in the developed world. You can't ta start talking about socialism in America until there's a functioning public education system. Okay? So, yes, there's distributive problems, but if you're talking about distributive justice in America, you're getting ahead of yourself. We're not at Marx yet. We're at Rousseau. We need to start talking about basic public education. It can't begin to organize until it has a functioning healthcare system, and etc. You don't even have to worry about Maoism when the most impoverished are told by their religious leaders and believe that what they need to do to get ahead is to work harder, and that what's preventing them from getting ahead is the government and the government's policies designed to strangle the free market. That's where the working class is. The working class blames the government for strangling the free market. How do you get somewhere with that? You need education before you can even think about getting to the next step. America is not an advanced capitalist country. Maybe it was 50 years ago. Today, it's an impoverished third world, backwards, rural backwater. So yeah, in a lot of ways, Sanders is a front. But it's less that he's conspiring to give legitimacy to a party that doesn't deserve any, and more that they're playing him like a fool. And that the fact that he keeps walking into these traps and not really reacting properly might demonstrate that he is a fool. At the end of the day, he might be the only person that really believes in what he's pushing. Because he's the only person that's naive enough to fall into it. He's really arguing for nothing more than the realization of the promises of Eleanor Roosevelt more than a half century ago. Minor concessions to capitalism that deliver the basic reward of the most fundamental human rights. And they are very minor concessions. So the article is rejecting them as insufficient, and they are, and they should be seen as insufficient, but you have to start somewhere. They have to be seen as basic starting points. Yes, they're insufficient, but America has no revolutionary potential right now, because it's been kept at the most basic levels of ignorance. It doesn't have anything resembling an education system. And its people are reared on institutional violence. They fight each other. They don't fight, you know, the bastards. They're simply too deeply brainwashed. And in that respect, Bernie is actually exactly what they needed, whether he gets crucified in the end or not. So yeah, I mean, the article is saying that he's not an end. Okay, he's not. And to see him as an end is an error. He's the very start. And everything has to start somewhere. And it has to start here in America. Because that's what they don't have, and what they need, is education and healthcare. Get this, this is their next shovel of nonsense here. There is no guarantee Mrs. Clinton will go along and embrace certain liberal ideas that she opposed during the campaign and that could make it tougher for her to win over independents in November. That's from the Wall Street Journal. Thanks, guys. That's their next round of absurdity. In order to win independents, Clinton needs to distance herself from Sanders' proposals. Because her ideas, being more moderate, will be more popular with independents, who are between the Republicans and the Democrats, rather than to the left of the system, which is what all evidence suggests. It really takes a lot of gall to push that kind of argument. When everybody knows that she lost independence by 50%. He won independence by huge margins. The only reason he had a chance at all was because he was winning independence. If they were all closed primaries, he might have won Oregon. Or he did win Oregon. But I mean, he probably wouldn't have had the momentum to win Oregon. If the entire schedule was closed primaries, Bernie Sanders would probably not have won a seat, or would not have won a state. He needed independence. And then they turn around and say that she'll be better positioned to win independence? They don't even care if it makes sense, okay? They tell you what's true. They tell you what the evidence says. If something contradicts them, they delete it. And it's about framing things. It's about telling you what's true, not about analyzing things and coming to, you know, a concept of truth, right? So I mean, like, what people get cynical and tune out. I mean, it's what there's no other approach, right? And then, you know, the nihilists end up in control of things. Like I say, we have to take the education system back first. We have to reestablish a concept of truth. If nothing is true, then Clinton is the candidate that we deserve. There's also more on this assisted dying mess in Canada. The provincial government is saying that they want to allow hospitals to opt out at the bureaucratic level. And pretty much everybody is saying that that's no good. I don't agree with it myself either. Healthcare shouldn't be seen as a market transaction, which is the basis of this decision, but as a right. So denying access to services would fall under the denial of a right. You have to remember again that the Liberals in Canada are Liberals, which means that they read a lot of nonsense, like Rawls, right? Rawls is considered a liberal. I think Rawls is just disingenuous. I mean, this is a party that was led by Michael Ignatieff at one point, right? This is what this is technical liberalism, right? Hayek would have called himself a liberal, right? So their concept of rights, in an academic liberal sense, are going to be not seen well by a lot of the people in the country at a lot of times. And in fact, our Supreme Court is more libertarian than liberal. So our Supreme Court tends not to fall into these, you know, modern liberal conceptions and falls more into what we would consider as modern libertarian ideas, right? And they wouldn't, our Supreme Court is not going to buy this conscience rights argument. It's going to say you've got a right to, they don't want to balance rights or, you know, pit rights against each other or have one right as more powerful than the other, right? And that's essentially what the government is saying here. They're saying that, okay, your conscience rights are more powerful. You know, you have conscience rights, it's absolute. Our courts won't take that argument. Which is not to say the doctor should be forced to carry out the procedure either. Exactly, right? They have every right to quit and protest. But for a doctor to deny access to the service, conscience rights are not rights. They're the absence of rights. The idea of a conscience right is incoherent. To say that I have the right to deny you of a right is not... It's a mockery of the concept of a right. And you see it come out on the right, right? The truth is that the argument that the Liberals are presenting here is something that you would be more likely to see from, you know, like a Wild Rose Party. It's in Canada, it's considered very right-wing to argue for conscience rights. And it's disappointing. But that said, I realize that my opinions and the opinions that you're seeing come out in print are not entirely in line with Canadian jurisprudence either. Canadian law is going to look at what I'm saying and say, okay, you're right, but you're not being very reasonable. Right? And so the law would suggest that in order to uphold the person's right to have access to the service, you don't need to force people to make the choice to administer or quit. Although, I think, you know, if you're not going to do your job, you can go home. I would hold to it out of principle, right? They would say that, okay, so long as there's somebody around that's willing to perform the procedure, then, you know, why are you forcing this person to do it when the person beside them will do it? It's unreasonable, right? What the government's going to look at are things like reasonable access. If you have, let's say for example, you have somebody in a rural area, there's only one doctor for a 400 mile radius, and that doctor won't do it, the court will say that doctor has to do it. Because in order for the person to get access, that's the only option that they have. And they'll say that if you won't do it, then get out of here, we'll put somebody else in this shit that will, right? So it's a balancing act. The court isn't going to take a really strict position from either perspective, so much as it's going to ensure that the access to the service exists. And if the government wants to set up laws that restrict access, then the court will tear the laws down. However it is that it wants to do this, it'll give them a lot of space to let doctors make choices. But at the end of the day, the patient has to be able to make, it has to gain access, right? So if you're in a big metropolitan area like Toronto, you can find someone, everybody knows you can find someone. It's, there's no use in forcing somebody to do something they don't want to do when you can find someone that'll do it of their own free will, right? But if you're in the Northwest Territories, they'll take a different position. We're talking about Ontario, so contextually, if you're in Attawapiskat, then yeah, they'll force you to do it. And I think they should too. But the court's also going to want to avoid that, right? It's going to want to avoid those kinds of rulings. It's a last case scenario. It would be more likely to argue that you need to break up the situation that's led to this scenario. Or, the state needs to bring in more people, et cetera, than to actually force somebody to do something they don't want to do, right? And I mean, really, that's what the problem would be, right? Somewhere like, we don't even have to talk about Attawapiskat, we talk about Thunder Bay, right? If you can't find a doctor willing to, carry out a euthanasia in Thunder Bay, our court system is going to say, okay, well, the state needs to ensure that service is available there. It's not going to force you to do it exactly, but it will, force the government to go out and make sure that access to the services is available. And if the only way to do that is to force someone to do it, then, the order will come. So, I'm going to plead guilty to being hard-headed, but the law is not going to follow me in my rigidity to patient rights, and frankly, my outright rejection of the entire concept of conscience rights as incoherent. Okay, but the law may argue that allowing hospitals to opt out altogether is not the proper balance, and that's what I'm trying to get across. I think what everybody is trying to get across is that you can't let the hospital make the decision. The way the dust settles with this is going to have to be that the hospitals are going to have a department, right? So a hospital cannot make a conscience right argument. That is just a bureaucratic decision to deny access. The law will argue that it's needlessly belligerent to force individual doctors to administer, but that the hospitals must nonetheless provide active access that they can opt out. So the government is trying to say that the hospitals have the right to opt out. That will not be upheld in the Supreme Court. And the province should realize that and just not bother with a pointless legal battle that they know that they're going to lose. Like I say, conscience rights are something that the right wing invented in order to avoid giving people rights. There's no such thing as a conscience right. A conscience right is just, like I say, something that was just invented whole cloth by a bunch of conservatives that don't want to acknowledge that people have rights. So trans people have rights, for example. So because conservatives don't want to acknowledge that trans people have rights, they make up the idea of a conscience right. And that gives them an excuse to deny trans people of rights. It's a completely disingenuous, you know, again, just totally nihilistic approach to things. Completely immoral. And it has no place, really, in a serious discourse. So, what's the root cause here? What's the actual problem? The actual problem is that we have private hospitals in Ontario. If we had public hospitals, then there wouldn't be money talking here, and this wouldn't happen. Everybody could save their time. The entire concept of their argument is not—it's not legally valid, right? There's no such thing as a conscience, right? It's a bunch of nonsense.
It depends on what the definition of radical Islamic terrorism is.
It's like an episode of Seinfeld, except without the irony. You know, I'm pretty sure that there's someone that's fucking with my typing in order to make me look less literate. Okay. This is the, you know, do you say Islamic terrorism or do you not say Islamic terrorism? It's a stupid debate, but she came. She let him define a narrative. She let him say that, you know, the Democrats never say this. And then she went out and she said it. That's a huge victory for Donald Trump to get her to say that. She can't let him define a narrative like that. If she does that, then the election becomes a joke, and he wins by default. He gets to say all kinds of stupid things, and then she just caves. I've been over this. Okay, the moment that you take him seriously, it's done, it's over. But this is the problem. This is what the left has been saying the whole time, is that her natural instinct is to cave, because she actually agrees with him. And you're too fucking stupid to see that she agrees with him. No, yes, you're a fucking idiot if you can't see that she agrees with him. And I'm sorry, but don't be so fucking stupid then, okay? And that's what's happening, is that she's folding to this because she doesn't want to be on the other side of the debate in the first place. That's her entire strategy, to control the center, to throw away the left. When he pulls her in like that, she loses in both directions, okay? Blame it on Bernie Sanders if you want, but I'm not crying about it. We had to do that. We had to make her look. You know, we had to pull her into the left, because otherwise she would have run from the right in the first place. But as it is, when he manages to pull her in like that, because she's trying to define herself as moderate, quote unquote, you know, moderate in the American political discourse means extreme right, right? When she tries to do that, and by caving to what she's saying, by agreeing with him, the right doesn't interpret her that way, okay? Because they've set her up as the enemy. They see that as she's weak, she's caving, she's falling apart to his demands. And that's what the left sees too, right? From either direction, they just see her falling apart. It's a triviality, but it's bigger than the triviality of the actual issue. It's the broader scope, right? But the thing is that it doesn't make sense for her to push back, because she can't do it credibly. Why people bit and screamed and fought. No, we're not going along with this. We do expect her to push back against it, even if we do realize it's kind of trivial. We don't expect her to say the words, we expect her to hold to the argument. It's a matter of principle to avoid linking the two things to avoid falling into the trap of xenophobia. But that's not the way she sees it. You know, she wants the Leviathan. She's not less xenophobic than him. She's not. Okay? She's a neocon. She wants the, you know, to build up the enemy, the whole Straussian argument. She's perfectly happy to work people up against an enemy if it results in, you know, the coming together of America versus the world. That's what she wants. The same as him. So, I mean, the narrative has to be that she's caving because the right expects her to oppose him. And if she agrees with him, then he's, you know, he was right. And she's weak. The left expects, the left doesn't agree with him and expects her to oppose him and gets, you know, lost when she agrees with him. In fact, the left is going to deny it, really, right? They'll deny that she's in agreement with him. That's what Democrats are great at denial. They're great at cognitive dissonance, right? And so what is this election? This election is belligerent asshole versus belligerent asshole light. Ding. And that's what she actually wants. She thinks that, you know, we'll pick the light mayonnaise. The light asshole, right? But, I mean, that's not America, right? That's not a contest. Americans pick the fucking mayonnaise. They get their heart attacks. They clog their arteries. They make their bad choices, and they're happy about it. They stand up for it, because that's freedom to make bad choices. And look at it from the other side, right? It's day one, and she's already caving on Islamophobic language. They haven't even voted in D.C. yet. And she's already running running to the right as fast as she can get there. Do you think she's going to hold her base? This is a disaster. And it's going to be a disaster, okay? By October, she'll be supporting the wall. Mark my words. She'll build a bigger wall. A more American wall. And if that doesn't work, then by the end she'll be standing meekly beside him and applauding his every racist statement. Let's be real. Isn't that what she's actually always done? Stood beside Clinton and applauded his racist statements. Stood beside Bush and applauded his racist statements. Stood beside Obama and applauded his cryptically racist statements. Why wouldn't you expect her to ultimately stand beside Trump and support his racist statements? To adopt his ideas if she thinks they're popular. That's what we have in front of us here. At the end of it, Clinton will support Trump. You want that? If you don't, then you need to get behind another candidate. Headlines, you know, floating back and forth, you know, arguing this over that. Now, that's not, you know, the headline I want to see. Clinton caves on Islamophobic language. That's the headline I want to see. I'm no advocate of strong leader rhetoric. Don't misunderstand me here. I don't, you know, I'm not about getting someone to have the trains run on time. Hillary Clinton is a follower. And if Trump leads, she will get in line behind him. Don't be surprised. Every stupid thing that he says, in the end, she'll agree with him. Because he says it in a belligerent, you know, macho sort of way. You made your bed, Democrats. Now you've got to lie in it. Yeah, it's the 14th. We haven't talked much this week, have we? I don't want to make it seem like it was like a week off or something. It certainly didn't feel that way. You'll get plenty of rants from me, that's for sure. The narration kind of lapsed. I think I pointed out a few days ago that it was just a consequence of kind of feeling like I'm in between things. I can say at 3 o'clock in the morning, almost, on June 14th, that I have finally got all my archiving completed and condensed, right? So, what I wanted to start doing at the beginning of... Well, I guess it would have been last week. It would have been... Yeah, I wanted to start on this around the 6th or 7th. And I'm gonna not start on it until probably the 15th or 16th. Has been done. So what have I done in the last week? Well, I cleared down my Facebook, my music Facebook page got wiped. And then I had to combine my Death to Koalas stuff into my main profile page, and there were many of them. Ended up combining many Word documents together. The end result ended up being a rather absurd over 5,000 pages and nearly 2 million words. It's a really ridiculously long. I want to make sure I got that. Yeah, because that stuff is a blur. I got to make sure that I got everything together there. Like, it's ridiculous, but that's what I got. But that's still only a small amount of the writing that I've done. I'm writing well over 1,000 pages a year. Closer to 1,500 pages a year. So, that's what I'm doing. You know, whatever it is I'm ranting about. You know, sometimes it's random science YouTube videos. Sometimes it's, you know, last year this time, I guess I was mostly going on about the issue in Ukraine, geopolitics, election stuff. It's just whatever is the thing, right? And the primary got me. The general's not, right? So I've got to wipe down that page. I've got a few more days of sort of in-betweenness. The rest of today is going to be spent combining things. But with the vlog, I gotta eat, and when I'm done eating, it's gonna be wiping down, the vlog, right, and that's gonna take a few days. Like, it's backed up 10 days, and there's a lot there, because I kinda lost it around the printer, right, so, lots of stuff coming up. It's gonna be, this is like, no point even pointing it out, right? By the time you hear it, I'll have caught up. That's the point of that, right? Yeah, it's just more, I'm just taking note of the reality here that I'm shifting over. I'm gonna have to get some sleep between now and the Joy Formidable show. But things will be going back to normal. Like I say, it's not... Don't think of it like a week off or 10 days off. That's the wrong way to think of it. It's more like, I really have not done anything for the last 10 days besides sit and type and copy and paste, right? So that document was about 3,000 pages 2 weeks ago. It's now over 5,000, so you can see that I did quite a bit of copying and pasting. It had to line it all up, right? So I had the YouTube stuff dated and the Facebook stuff dated, and I had to merge them, right, combine them. So it was like running through copy paste, right? And it wasn't just the YouTube stuff moving into the Facebook document. There was also a number of smaller files that had to get moved into. There's a text document full of replies that had to be moved in because it was after they broke YouTube in my browser and whatnot. So there really just wasn't much to narrate, you know. I could have come on at the end of the day and been like, well, today I copied over, you know, 1,200 pages worth of material, but I mean, it didn't strike me as particularly relevant. Although I need to also point out that it's partly because it took so much longer than I wanted to, right? I just kind of kept thinking that once it's done, I'll update it, right? Which is what I'm doing right now. But this is like 5 or 6 days late, right? So be it. Everything takes longer than I wanted to. So, I will no doubt do a lot of ranting for the rest of the evening, but it won't be direct face. It'll be stuff that's already come up by now. I'm ultimately getting ready for the show, and I'll return to proactive or active vlogging starting tomorrow. So I didn't point out what that means, though, regarding the Aleph discs, which are what I've been supposed to be working on right now. As I mentioned the last time, it kind of doesn't make sense anymore because of the separate blog and the alter reality. So, I mean, I'm not gonna write 3 years worth of blogs ahead of time, right? So, that's something I can't really do. I think that I just this is every time I think about it, my head blows up, right? It's just so complicated. I'm trying to understand everything that I'm going to do at once. I can't do it, right? So I have to do one thing at a time. And the thing that I'm going to be doing next is rebuilding my Bandcamp site, which is currently completely unpublished. What does that mean? Well, it means taking note of release dates on a song-by-song basis. It means rewriting write-ups. It means rebuilding the music Facebook page. And it means ensuring that everything is in the Word document so that when it comes back up in the log, it's ready to go. I don't know if I can pre-post Blogspot stuff. But if I can, then I might as well. I know that I can pre-post YouTube stuff, and that I might as well. Maybe I can sync them. I know that I can pre-post Facebook stuff, and I might as well. So, etc. I'll see how that works when it comes up, but. And the other thing I'm going to be doing is massive listening. For the first, 12 releases anyways, which will take me up until the middle of 1998. There is still a gap there that I kind of forgot about. I stopped after the first record. leaving a gap between the first record and the, well, I mean, I need to rebuild singles, and I need to rebuild the second record, right? All of the things around the second record just never came up, right? So there's going to be 5 or 6 singles for the second record with all the remixes, like the first one. I'm going to have to resequence it instrumentally. That'll need to be done on the other machine. I'm going to work my way back up, right, to the point where I get there, right? So, release dates will need to be, well, it's going to be complicated, right? So it's going to be between 2013 and now, right? Depending on what it is. So, like I say, every time I think about it, my head blows. But when I get back from the show, I'll no doubt still have some vlog catch up to do, and I'll want to catch up right till that day, right? So I'm going to need to do, 12 days worth of vlogs. When I get back, but after that, I'll finally be ready to sit down and start rebuilding what I was doing. The next chunk of time is between the 14th and the 21st. I don't know what I'll get done by the 21st, considering that I need to do a lot of listening in the process as well, right? But I should at least get a start. And I think I should be, by the end of June, I should be back, at least started the remixing process for my second disc. That's what I'm planning with that. This is a transfer over. I suppose I'll have to start a new season around then too. And that's fine. This was what I broadcast it to be. And that will be what I broadcast it to be too. So, I know this is not particularly exciting, but if you're following the music, it's the music production, which is what I want you to do, right? All this other stuff is just secondary. The vlog is about making music. It's getting back on track. What set me into this detour that has taken me 6 months to get back to where I was, it's quitting smoking, right? And in fact, it's now been 6 months since I bought a pack of cigarettes. Again, as I pointed out before, I've been sitting here for 10 days and like I didn't even want to go out and go buy a pack of cigarettes. Like, the thought never even crossed my mind. So, I'm confident. I'm totally confident that's conquered, right? Even if I have a few when I go out, with the understanding that I will be going out less, for most of the summer. I think, right? After the show tonight, I don't know if. I'm looking either at 1 or 2 shows probably for the rest of the month, right? I'm not sure. It's either going to be just this, and either I've got shows on the 21st and 23rd penciled in, but I don't know how many of those I'm going to hit actually. All right, so and I've got, I've got like week long periods in between. It's much better than these, go out for a few days, then, or go out, stay in for, 2 days, which is just enough time to, catch up and, eat and, sober up, and then I'm back out. That was a long streak of that, but, that's not actually my normal life. That was, unusual. And looking ahead in July, it's, I'm going to Swans, there's no question. There's an I'm Mother Earth show that I couldn't imagine myself missing. Besides that, it's kind of thinking about maybe seeing, Genesis Peorage, but I mean, it's like, it's because I'm very familiar with his work that I know that. I mean, like, it's not like he's gonna read something off a sheet and, like, you know, make some funny faces or something. Like, it's not gonna be that interesting, right? It's the reality. It's more just like getting to see the icon, right? And I skipped Faust. You know, I skipped, what else did I skip? There's a bunch of stuff I skipped that just I decided, eh. But I am more interested in Jen. It's, I'm more of a Quail fan than a Throbbing Gristle fan. That's the thing, right? I'm certainly very familiar with his work, but it's not... I never connected to it the way that I connected to Quail, right? And I think there's good reason it's not anywhere near as interesting to listen to. And I may have wanted to see the White Lung show in July as well, but I mean, their new record's just not that good, right? So, I mean, I'll check out some of the other stuff, some of the smaller shows, and see what's going on, but I don't expect, like, it's going to be... I could foreseeably only go out twice in July. Like, for real, right? That's something that could happen. The Swan show and the Out of the Earth show. And I didn't see anything else, right? And then August, I've got nothing as of right now, right? So, and I went over this once before. That was expected. I don't expect lots of shows like that in Detroit. I got kind of an unusual patch there. Although it did happen last year too, in that period. Afterwards, it really died down, right? It was like, I didn't go out at all last summer. There was a few shows I could have gone to that I skipped, but like it wasn't a lot. If I find myself trapped in the music, that might happen again. I don't know. Right now, like I say, I'm finally, I've been saying this for a while, and something else happens, right? Who knows, maybe when I come back from the show tomorrow, I think this will probably be an all-nighter. I don't know, it really depends on what time the show's done at, but I'm in Ferndale. I gotta catch the bus, I think, at midnight, if I want to get back in time. They play long sets, so, and I mean, I'm not gonna leave early, right? When I saw Screaming Females last year, they finished, like the set was done at 12:01. And I'm looking at it thinking, fuck. You know? Like, you finished, like, I had to catch the 12 o'clock bus, the set's done at 12:01. It's just like, and I think that might happen again, but, you know, I gotta eat it. It's gonna be nice out at least, right? Like, not warm, but like I'm not gonna freeze to death, so I don't know. Maybe I'll stop at a bar or something afterwards. I have no idea how that's gonna work out, but I don't expect to be back until the morning. I might surprise myself though too, right? It's hard to say. All I can say is that when I do get back, I plan to work on the vlogs for a bit and then actually get back to work. Which means I should actually finally get my gear section into. Which I've been talking about for a month. So yeah, this is long overdue, but finally here. Cross our fingers that when I get back from the show and I've caught up on the vlogs, everything is ready to go and I don't have another hurdle or a detour that I have to deal with. I am hungry, very hungry, so I'm going to tend to that. History is not destiny, but right now what it seems like we're reliving is Gore versus Bush. The similarities are actually really startling. While Bush had the party behind him, he was widely seen as unfit to run. His intelligence was correctly widely mocked. Gore's opinion of Bush was so clearly abysmal that he could barely be bothered to debate with him. He never saw him as a serious opponent. The incumbent is popular in the center, but loathed by both the left and the right. And the left signaled very clearly that it was not going to elect Gore unless he swung left, which he never did. A lot of people argue that the lesson is that you don't run a third-party candidate, but that's the wrong lesson. Gore has given us no reason to think he would have been any different than Bush. Remember, Gore was instrumental in the sanctions against Iraq that killed millions of children. And he is on the record repeatedly as not just supporting the invasion, but supporting the surge before the invasion even happened. To suggest that Gore would have been less of a hawk is not living in reality. Gore was arguably more hawkish than Bush. The real lesson here is not for voters, but for Democrats. Hillary is hurtling down exactly the same path that Gore was. And if that's not corrected, you're going to see the same outcome, if not a worse one, as Sanders is much stronger than Nader ever was. We have a historical model. Like, do you want to repeat this as farce, or do you want to try to stop it?